Barts Health NHS Trust Archives and Museums holds archives, artworks and objects which tell many stories of nearly 900 years of healthcare in the city and East London. This video explores just one of these stories, a look behind the scenes of the London Hospital's pioneering light department. The statue of Queen Alexandra, which stands outside the Royal London Hospital, holds a clue to a remarkable chapter in the hospital's history. On the base of the statue, which was designed by George Edward Wade in 1907, is a bronze bas-relief depicting Alexandra and her husband, King Edward VII, visiting the London Hospital in 1903. The royal couple are watching a nurse carrying out a procedure underneath an elaborate piece of equipment, the first of its kind in Britain at the time. In 1899, Alexandra, then Princess of Wales, paid a visit to the Finson Institute in her native city of Copenhagen, Denmark. The institute was named after the Danish Faroese physician Niels Finson, and it was pioneering a new treatment of lupus vulgaris, a disfiguring skin condition caused by the tuberculosis bacillus and not related to lupus, the autoimmune disease. It was previously thought of as incurable and treated with painful procedures such as scraping, burning, and the application of acid. However, the Finson Institute was claiming to cure 70% of cases. This new treatment involved an electric arc lamp invented by Niels Finson himself. He had observed that invisible light, particularly ultraviolet rays, had a bactericidal effect on skin tissue. By this time, it was already known that light had antibacterial properties and that tuberculosis was caused by a bacteria which died when exposed to sunlight. It therefore became common practice to expose patients with various forms of TB to as much fresh air and sunlight as possible. However, even strong sunlight was not intense enough to successfully treat skin conditions such as lupus vulgaris. Finson's lamp used telescopic arms and lenses to focus the ultraviolet rays onto the infected area of skin. The lamp also had apparatus to exclude heat rays and to compress the skin to improve the treatment. For his work in developing the science of phototherapy, as it came to be known, Finson received the Nobel Prize for Physiology or Medicine in 1903. Alexandra saw the potential to introduce this pioneering treatment to Britain. She was already a devoted supporter of the London Hospital and persuaded the hospital's chairman to find out more about the treatment. A physician and two nurses were sent to Copenhagen to learn the technique, and in May 1900, the London Hospital opened the country's first light department. Alexandra herself donated the hospital's first Finson lamp. To power it, the hospital had to install a transformer, as the electrical current supplied by the public mains was not enough. The original lamp now forms part of the Science Museum collection. In 1901, the newspaper proprietor Sir Alfred Harmsworth donated £10,000 towards a second lamp and the costs of the new department. For the first 3 years of its existence, the light department operated in a temporary hut in the hospital garden, and was supervised by the two sisters who had studied at the Finson Institute in Copenhagen. Patients would either lie on a couch or sit in a chair so that the lens could be focused on the affected areas of skin. Four patients could be treated under a single lamp. Patients were also treated outdoors in the hospital garden with a simpler apparatus which used a lens to concentrate the sun's rays onto the skin. The nurses operating the lamps had to be carefully trained and endowed with stamina and patience. It was physically demanding work, as the nurses had to remain very still for up to 2 hours at a time to keep the lamp in alignment and the patient's skin compressed during the treatments. The procedures could be noisy and smelly, and the nurses had to wear overalls and goggles to protect themselves from sparks which would sometimes fly from the lamps. In 1903, the Queen Alexandra Light Department, as it was renamed, moved into more spacious accommodation in the hospital's new outpatients block. This was opened by the King and Queen on the 11th of June 1903, the event depicted on Alexandra's statue. The following year, four more lamps were donated to keep up with the growing demand. The treatments, for lupus vulgaris and other bacterial skin conditions, were often continued for months or years, depending on the severity of the condition. No wonder that Alexandra suggested the motto, "Nothing like perseverance," which was inscribed on one of the ceiling beams. The light department continued to thrive throughout the first half of the 20th century, with over 20,000 treatments being given each year. These are detailed in the patient case books and photographs which survive in the archives. From 1922, patients were also treated with general ultraviolet rays from carbon arc lamps in rooms on the roof of the outpatients block. This, together with localized UV treatments, raised the success rate from 70% to 90%. These lamps used winding gear to produce electrical sparks which generated ultraviolet light. They could be used to treat various deficiency diseases, as well as skin conditions, including lupus vulgaris. This carbon arc lamp was used to treat King George V for his recurring lung problems in 1928 to 1929, and was subsequently donated by him to the hospital. It is now on display in the Royal London Hospital Museum. In 1936, a modified lamp was introduced to the light department. The Lumholt lamp had an inbuilt skin compressor which freed up the nurse, who could now supervise three lamps at one time. The lamp also cut treatment time down to 30 minutes. Following the introduction of effective drug treatments for tuberculosis, the light department closed in 1950. While light treatment is still used today for conditions such as seasonal affective disorder, the dangers of excessive ultraviolet rays on the body are now better understood. However, the story of the light department reveals the London Hospital's readiness to experiment with new techniques and technologies to improve patient care and treatment. We hope you've enjoyed this video. You can find out more about Barts Health Archives and Museums via the link below and follow us on Twitter and Instagram.